Hey, what's up? This is Ken Susi from the band Unearth, and before you watch my rig rundown with Premier Guitar, ask yourself the question, why are so many great artists moving over to Fishman Fluence? If you want to find out, check the link below.
Right on. What's up? This is Perry with Premier Guitar. We got Ken Susi today from Unearth. I've been waiting to do this one for a long time because Ken has really stepped up his internet game, and he's demoing a lot of gear. He's playing a lot of stuff. He's trying a lot of new stuff, and I really appreciate that. So Ken, thanks so much for being with us today.
Hey Perry, thank you very much, man. It's awesome to be here. I'm a huge fan of everything that you guys do. You guys have always been super kind to my band, so it's an honor to be here.
Let's start from the beginning. You have a signature ESP7, and I think I read they started making a 6 version of it just because so many people were requesting it, right?
Yeah, let me show it to you. I got this cool guitar. It's the KSM7, and it's like my little Silver Surfer guy. Let me just be able to see my guitar. But yeah, it's great. It's a mahogany body, ebony fretboard, maple top. All the things that I really wanted. I had a signature before this, which was a quilted maple version. Sorry, I'm getting a little bit of my screen in there, but it was a quilted maple version, and it sounded cool and stuff, but I really, really liked the thickness of the M body. It was just like totally, like, it feels like a man's guitar, and I've put it up and I've A-beat it against, like, other guitars that, you know, don't have the Evertune in it, and it sounds really, really damn good. And, you know, when designing the guitar, I wanted to make sure that it was very clean, so if somebody wanted to, you know, buy the guitar, they wouldn't have to deal with like anything other than my signature on the back. But yeah, this guitar is like, it's funny. Like, so many people ask me like, oh, you get, you know, ESP guitars and all this other great stuff, but you know, do you use them? Do they make you special guitars? And I'm like, I play legitimately what is off the line. And, this guitar is like, this is like the greatest thing ever for me. I just love all the aesthetics that are on it.
Yeah, I love the almost super strat kind of look, but with the practicality of the Evertune, and that's just so rad, man. Does it currently come in any of the other color options or just silver for right now?
Let me reach over here because you're probably seeing it in the background. I wish it came in this color, but I did another version of this, and they were kind of dead set against it, but I made them use Dayglow paint, which they don't normally do. But this is also, it's the same version of my guitar, but just in Desert Sun Yellow. But this is an actual ESP, fret dots, the whole nine. I put a Floyd Rose on it and Strat knobs on it just because it was more appropriate. I love Evertune, and I use it on basically everything. Oh, yeah, I use it on basically everything. So, you know, the thing about the Evertune is when I got one, I didn't think it was going to work. And I remember they sent me an ESP that had it, and I was saying to myself, I'm going to play this until, like, either the strings break or the guitar goes out of tune. And sure enough, I lasted 3 weeks on a tour, and I started breaking strings when they were rusty. But it held tune perfectly, and I was, at that point, I was really sold. Cosmos, the owner, is literally one of the greatest guys ever, and I'm really, really, you know, honored that they... you know, that they would like, you know, give me bridges for free and you know, obviously endorse me. And the relationship I've built with them over the years has just been so great.
Yeah, man, those things are mind blowing. Just out of curiosity, with a big ass chunk of mahogany like that and the Evertune, how much does it weigh? Is it like, LP territory or?
About 50 pounds. No, I'm just kidding. no, I don't know how much it weighs. Let's just say this. It's comfortable. I grew up playing Ibanez's my whole career, and they make a great guitar. Let's just say that it's probably the same weight as an RG, if not a little bit heavier. But I gotta say, I was really worried about like the amount of wood this takes out, and in some guitars there is some effect to that. Sometimes people like it when you take out a little bit of wood, you know, and it gives it like a thinner tone. But for me, I really wanted as much wood as possible, and some guys put this little, you know, the arch here, whatever they call that, the arch top,
scoop.
Or the scoop. Yeah. I wanted it flat just because I wanted to maintain as much wood and as I could. And the cool thing is Joel from Killswitch has a great comparison signature. And when I was writing the new record, I tried one, and I put this up against it, and I thought it was like pound for pound. I mean, they both have Fluence pickups, so they sound great, but they sounded really good together. So if someone was worried about the Evertune sound making the guitar sound weird, I think my guitar, I designed this specifically so, you know, you maximized, you know, the amount of wood on the guitar and the tone and all that other good stuff.
So you kind of maintain the resonance with and still have that, the bridge. Another cool thing about your signature and specifically is that the price point is pretty low, man. If you wanted to buy an Evertune bridge and have it installed on a guitar and take it to a shop, you know, it's a bit of an investment. And your guitar, I mean, what is it? I think it MSRP was like, what, $1,600?
It's like $1,500. And obviously with Fluence and the Evertune, you know, it makes the guitar a little bit more expensive. But, excuse me, but it's amazing because you're getting so much more out of the guitar. Like, if you were to grab another guitar with said other companies' pickups and no Evertune, like, I would guarantee you that this guitar would trump that in sonic quality and built-in craftsmanship. I mean, I was really particular about the neck profile and how much material, whatever they call it, polyurethane or whatever they put on the back of the neck. So I was really, really conscious of, like, the guitar looking, feeling, and sounding good. And ESP always nails it. And everyone over there is super professional and always, like, Todd Binder over there is really awesome. So he totally gets it.
Yeah. We had Chris Keys and I, the other premier guitar guy, had the opportunity to go to Tokyo to take a look at their custom shop. And man, like, their attention to detail kind of was mind-boggling. It almost puts us to shame. It made me feel like America was a third world country, honestly.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of guys that do that. I mean, ESP is definitely one of them. They take really good care of me, and all the guitars they've ever built me feel really good. And you know, when I made the move over from everyone knows me as an Ibanez guy prior to that, you know, when I moved over, I really always liked rosewood, but I never knew why I liked the ebony fretboard. But once I like grabbed an ESP, I was like, oh yeah, this feels the way I want it to feel. So ebony, you know, having that ebony fretboard was just great at that time for me.
You know, obviously there might be a slight tonal difference, but is there anything that you could articulate that would be the difference between the rosewood and the ebony? Is it, because I feel like ebony is just a little faster for some reason. I don't know why.
It is.
It's like less sticky?
Yeah, you're totally right. Like ebony feels a little bit faster when you're playing it and smoother, just a touch. But I also feel it has like a bit of that more like spank. It gives it a little bit more of a brighter tone, just a tiny bit. So that was important to me. And I listen, like, when you play, like, I learned how to play guitar on an Ibanez guitar, and it's the only guitar I had all the way up until I signed with ESP. So I didn't really know any better. But then once I grabbed an ESP, I was like, yeah, like, okay, this is cool. And I never knew I loved the H style body as much as I did until I picked one up.
One last question about the Evertune before we move on to other details. But are you locking, like, say, the top three or four strings and then leaving the bottom open so you can bend and solo and stuff? Because I've noticed that you don't get a lot of bend out of that sucker when it's hunkered down.
The way I do my guitar is very unique, and I'll show my guitar again. So when I string a guitar, which I just string this, and I literally didn't even stretch the strings out, so this is going to be a great little exercise. When I do this, I tuned the string to the spot where it like doesn't bend anymore. So we're tuned to drop B. So my highest string is F sharp. And then this string right here is an F sharp, right? And these two are B. So what ends up, and these are nines, right? So what I do is I tune it so it's in the non-bend mode. Then I start turning the keys until we get to the point where, okay, this is just about to bend, but I don't go any further. Then I fine tune it with the Allen key, get it right with the tuner, and then just start touching this to that breaking point. And from there, it will play like a normal guitar. So I'll show you right now. So as you can see, while I'm playing, it feels like a normal guitar, and it is a normal guitar.
Right, and it goes right back. That's wild.
So many people, yeah, so many people are like, I just couldn't figure it out. I couldn't figure it out. And I'm like, yeah, you're just not doing it right, you know?
All right, well, that is super handy, obviously. That's got to save you a ton of time on the road. Just pull your guitar out of the case and it's in tune. That's great.
Well, let me add to that. So I use Spurzel locking tuners on the top. Not on this guitar, just because my guitar is currently being worked on in California at ESP. But what I'll say is I string the strings through, I lock it, and just crank it until I hear it in tune, and then I cut the strings, and then I literally like do my little thing. But my time, especially with the Spurzels, I cut down like so much time changing strings. I buzz to see me change a string on stage. You know, like I'll just throw a string in and do this, and then it's already in tune. That's the other thing I really like is once these guitars are kind of set up with the Evertune, you could break a string, and let's just say in a pinch, you like run a string through it real fast and tighten it and turn it. Like you're literally back in tune pretty quickly or really, really
that
close.
That almost sounds like magic.
Dude, I'm
so
all about
magic. I've never
magic.
Owned a guitar with an Evertune. Is it like a complicated system of springs and shit in the back or?
Yeah. There's a lot of springs in the back and it's a whole spring-based system. I couldn't tell you how it works, but it's a fascinating design. I wish they made a lower profile one where, you know, it takes up less real estate in your guitar. But other than that, I record my records with them. It just sounds great.
Is there any learning curve when palm muting on that bridge? Because it is kind of a hunk, you know?
Oh, thanks for calling me a hunk. No, it works great. Like, I'll show you again. I mean, it works just fine. It feels right on your hand.
So it just feels just like a normal guitar when you're palm muting?
Yeah, it feels absolutely like a normal guitar. Nothing is different. I wouldn't play it if it wasn't, like, if it didn't feel right. And I'm even such a stickler. Back when I used to play the Floyd Rose bridges on the Ibanezes, I used to block the bridge. So, because, like, I always used to, like, you know, lean my hand hard on them, especially when I wasn't really using a whammy, so I used to block them. So I was very particular for many years on how I would rest my hand while I was playing. And once I moved over to Evertune, like, all was forgotten. It was, you know, it worked. It was just great.
That rules, man. All right, let's move on to something. Let's move on to the pickups because, man, right now, the passive-active argument on guitar forums and stuff is all over the freaking place. And, hey, I might get shredded for this in the comments, but I fucking love an 8185 set, dude. Or 89, even. Like, I think they're great pickups. I don't mind the way they sound, especially for high-gain applications. I feel like they're very, very concise, especially, you know, compared to, like, you know, a JB or just a regular old humbucker. And I've heard people say that the Fluence is, like, well, it's kind of active, or it is active, or it's not active. And I know, you know, yours have like a passive mode. So maybe you could explain that to me because I'm kind of lost on that a little bit.
Yeah. No, it's a lot of people don't understand, but I'm really glad you guys took the time to, you know, ask me to be on here. And I'm not going to give you my Ken Susi, you know, Fishman sales pitch. I'm going to be genuinely, like, I'm going to be genuine with you about this. So when I actually first tried Fluence, I remember sitting down and I was just like, I was playing 81, 85 for my whole career. You know, obviously there's a lot of great, they make a lot of great pickups like EMG made them over the years. And there's a lot of great, like a legacy attached to that. And they're a great company. But I remember sitting down playing Fluence and I was like, wow, this sounds exactly like what I want my 81, 85 to sound like. And especially me being a seven string player, I always felt like there was a weird like degradation from, the six string to the seven string to the seven string to the eight string. I don't feel like they were tuning their pickups like the six string because I would hear so many six strings that sounded better than my seven string and so on and so forth. So that was my personal opinion. But when I met Larry Fishman and he went through the design of how Fishman, like the Fishman Fluence worked and how it was different from other pickups, that blew my mind. Like just the story and when you really think about it, the way Fishman works is that, like the Fishman Fluence pickups work is that there's, you know, for the past 80 years, people have been like taking a pickup, like a bobbin and just winding copper around it, right? So when you do that, there's a lot of inconsistencies, right? It's like literally like when you're, you know, put it into production, say you wind one that's perfect and you hand it off to production, you say, well, make this a million times, right? But what ends up happening, it's like me asking you to tie your shoes 1,000 times the same way, right? So there'd be times at Fishman where, you know, we have a shuttle guitar where we'd pull pickups in and out. We would line up like EMGs or Seymour Duncans. And like when I say all of them varied, like, I mean, they all sounded different, right? Wow. And I'm saying to myself, oh my God, like this was, that was the moment that changed my life. Like I was saying to myself, these pickups are all over the place. Now I'm starting to think about times when I was in the studio with the producer and I'm handing him basically the same Ibanez guitar, like S series or RG or, you know, my, you know, whatever it was. And they would be like, this guitar sounds like this. Oh, this guitar sounds like that. And they're like the producer was taste testing the pickups, you know, sorry, the guitars. And I realized I would say to myself, like, here's 25 guitars that supposedly to my producer sound like shit. And like this one is the great one. And then I would just basically throw all the guitars in a closet and forget about them, even though they're thousands of dollars. So it wasn't necessarily the guitar's fault. It was the pickups, the inconsistency of the pickups inside them. So when I met Larry Fishman, he showed me the Fishman Fluence technology, which was a 48 layer thinly sliced precision coil that was like made from some, you know, aerospace company, but Larry turned it into a pickup and it gave me, no, it was completely noise canceling. It was completely quiet, multi-voiced. Like when I say multi-voiced, you know, when I hit a switch on my guitar, it would go from active to passive or some passive tone to another passive tone independently, like soldering a guitar, you know, a pickups into a guitar. So I'm saying to myself, this is incredible. And then like the other part was the consistency. Larry would like, you know, task me with like, here's, you know, production just made these. Here's like 15 sets of pickups. Just throw them in the shuttle guitar and listen to them. And when I say that there was no difference in that tone, I mean, because Fishman has such a high quality control that their magnets kind of fit into a same spot and the coil is just set and it never leaves that like perfect winding. Like every time you hit the switch, it changes windings, but that precision coil always stays the same. I'm like, oh my God, this is like the greatest thing in the in the whole planet. So that's what really attracted me to Fishman. And at the beginning, a lot of people were like, oh dude, it's like a Kemper for your guitar. And I'm saying, no, it's not. Like, this is like the technology that's in your pickups right now is so old. It's like me saying, like, this is, you know, you have a tube television, right? From the 80s. And you're like, well, that tube television has so much character. And like, if you go and touch it, you know, like give you a spark or something, you know, whatever. It just looks cool. And you're like, yeah, that is cool. But when you see a high def television, you're like, oh my God. Like I, you know, I could see the pimples on people's faces. Fluence does that. There's a lot of naysayers out there about active technology or whatever they want to call it. I don't necessarily, you know, I don't necessarily chalk Fishman up as an active pickup per se. It's, in my opinion, it's a powered pickup because it needs power in order to run this perfect coil. Other than that, it's completely analog and it's an experience. That's wild. You know?
So speaking of powered, and then we'll move on, but how is it powered? Is it powered through your instrument cable or do you charge it?
Well, let me show you what my guitar does. And mind you, I literally pulled this out of an ESP box. They sent this to me, so it doesn't have the battery pack on it, but I'll show you one of the battery packs. But the way my guitar is set up, and when I talk about like multi-voiced pickups, this is a modern pickup set, right? Fluence modern 7-string set in nickel. Basically, the way this is voiced is that you have the down position is in its active mode, which it sounds like an active pickup. In voice 2, when you pull this up, it is a kind of like a passive, an aggressive passive mode, like a hot rodded pickup, but it's very passive. I would say it's very similar like what Dimebag played, but just way more tear your face off. So then you have a high frequency tilt that I don't have hooked up in this guitar. It's a cool little feature because when you're doing records and stuff like that, it just knocks off some of the top end on your guitar tone. And sometimes, like when you're trying to blend with a snare drum, you would pull it and it takes off a little top end on your guitar and your guitar might just fit in with the snare a little bit better, right? That's my application. But it's very, very, very hard to hear. It's like if you buy a set of Fluence, you might just like you know what you like and set it up that way and forget it. But this right here is pretty interesting. There's a lot of companies that, you know, put out a lower gained version of an active pickup, and they try to sell you on it. So, you know, for instance, you got EMGs and then you got EMGX. Totally cool, two cool pickups, right? This has a negative 6 dB gain reduction. So when you're playing in the down position, the active sound, I put this on my guitar because if you want a lesser output active sound, you just flick this up and then you got it right there.
Oh, that's rad.
Going over to this guitar real quick. The best part about the power, you could use a 9 volt with these pickups. This is a same thing, modern black nickel. But you can use these pickups with a 9 volt, but I don't like 9 volts personally because, you know, there'll be a number of times that I'm on stage and I'm playing in front of like 40,000 people and I'm saying to myself, like, did I change my battery? Like, you know what I mean? My guitar tone feels a little weird and it just ruins your show. Fishman invented this really cool thing in the back. It's the universal battery pack. And what that does is you basically plug it in. There's a lithium ion battery. It gives you 200 plus hours of charge time. But the coolest part about this is that it gives you 9 volts throughout the duration of when it's working. So in that 200 hours, it's always outputting 9 volts. And when it gets to 10 hours less than that, at the 10 hour mark, like when you know, where your battery's about to die, this little light right here starts flashing, but you still have 10 hours to charge your battery at that point.
All right, well, I think that covers your SIG at least. I know you're, you know, I've known you as an Ibanez guy from, you know, back in the day. Are you still playing any of those or is it mostly ESP stuff?
I play all ESP stuff and I was, let me show you a cool guitar. So I was like literally playing some like old school Ibanez Roadstars and stuff. I still have a cool Ibanez collection, but you know, through popular demand and all that other stuff, ESP basically called me up one day and they were like, yo, like we want to put your guitar as a 6-string. There was such a need for it. So they put it out as a 6-string model. And it's been selling really well. And now I just basically play this whenever I need a 6-string.
I've seen Unearth play fucking more times than I've seen my own dad, dude. I grew up in Syracuse. So there was a time where like, I saw you guys play twice a month at least, you know. And I've seen you play in all manner of amps, you know, old 5150 block letter. I've seen you play, I think the Fender EVH-3. What are you working with now?
Okay, if you can see here, they're like, Let me give you the story. These are all the amps that I'm kind of like taste testing. So by the history of Unearth is we've always been like a 5150 Mesa Boogie cab band, right? It's just the old school 5150s, the signatures or block letter. It was just one of those amps that you could always just kind of set and you could be in a foreign country and you wouldn't even have to touch your amp. Like, you know, you wouldn't have to listen to your amp. You kind of just fire it up and like, you know, set the settings a certain way. But I got to a point where you know, amp companies sometimes, you know, you change your taste, your ears just change. You know, you can't really be committed to one thing. But I've kind of come to the conclusion later in my life that amps kind of like I'm just like a guy may like, you know, brunettes, right? Like there's so many brunettes in the world, right? There's so many girls that have dark hair. You kind of figure out what your type is. And for me, it's like I've always liked a 5150 or a Marshall 800. I know those are two drastically different amps, but I like those two amps. So what do I like? I love Soldanos. I love the EVH stuff, the new stuff. I love Rev, and I love the new Synergy stuff. And I love VHT gear. I've always loved that stuff. So when you think about those amps, you say to yourself, well, some of those lean more Marshall than, you know, than 5150, and some of them lean more 5150 than Marshall. So it depends on what your ears, you know, what you want out of your tone. So I've kind of narrowed it down to just like three amps that I've been playing live and I just rotate them. It's the EVH 5150 Stealth. Absolutely. I use the 6L6. They're going to be sending me the EL34 version. I really want to try that. Yeah. I really love the Synergy stuff. Their new Soldano module is absolutely amazing. The SLO module, I'm in love with it. And I use that through a Fryett power amp 292 for live. In the studio, I run everything through a VHT 2150, which is basically the Fryett classic, I think he calls it. It's a It's a monstrous power amp. And the last head is Rev. I love Rev. The 100P, I have that behind me too. And that leans a little more Marshall. But it's definitely, it's an exciting
amp. Man, I got to agree with you. A couple of points. First and foremost, if you guys don't know about Synergy amps, it's kind of a cool idea. They're basically like plug and play module preamps. So, you know, technically, if you had a big enough dock, you could have, you know, an Ubershall, SLO 100, whatever, all in one, and then power it with a power amp. Super interesting. And then on to Rev. Man, Derek is doing some really cool stuff over there with the two notes, cab IRs and stuff. It's like, man, a lot of dudes are like, well, I only want to play real amps. It's like, all right, well, here you go, asshole. You know?
Well, yeah, that's where everybody gets. You get to the point where, like, some people think digital amps are great, and it works for some people. Like, Animals as Leaders does a great job with using the Axe Effect stuff, and the Axe Effect stuff's great. But, you know, what it comes down to is I want to know that I'm playing a man's amp. And then when it sounds awesome on stage, if I have to get, like, a, you know, not every miking environment is great backstage, and, you know, setting up ISO cabs and all that stuff is a pain in the ass. I love the Two Notes technology. I'm using Two Notes to just send the you know, it's basically like the cab setup that I have here at my studio, and it goes right to the front house every night, and I know that I have a consistent sounding guitar tone going out to the house. But on stage, I'm cranking a real amp and pushing air. It's nothing better than that.
All right, so beyond Unearth, for those of you guys that follow Ken, he's got a couple of different musical endeavors. Not all like super high gain metal either. So like well, obviously because of COVID, it isn't a possibility, but if Unearth was going to go on tour tomorrow, what would you be taking? The Synergy?
I'd be taking some, I'd be taking whatever that medication is that gets rid of COVID.
Hydroxychloroquine.
Yeah. No, since I just got the Synergy stuff, the last tour I just did was, we went out with Guar. I just took out the EVH stuff, and that sounded amazing. Warp Tour, I just took out the Rev stuff. So I just got the Synergy stuff all dialed in. So I would probably take that out right now just to see how it performs live, and I'm already loving it here. So, yeah, I'd probably take that out.
I mean, the Synergy stuff, let's be realistic. You either have to be a full-time touring musician or independently, you know, financially good to have a full setup of a Synergy, you know? I mean, obviously you could afford a preamp and a power amp probably, but man, like, they offer a lot of different stuff. Like, at NAMM this year, I heard the Steve Vai module, and it honestly, that and the SLO module were like, whoa, okay. I didn't expect it.
Yeah. Well, I was gonna say, I have a legit SLO X88R. It's a purple-faced, it's like, I don't know, it's unobtainable. Like, that power amp's so hard to find, they're worth so much money. And I run that through the 2150, which is like this robust VHT, has KT88s, and it's just like massive sounding. I believe Metallica used to use those back in the, you know, Master Puppets or Justice for All days to basically put every amp through it. But, I'm going to say that, like, I match that with, like, a Fryette 292 with the Synergy SLO module. And I have a YouTube review page called Lord of the Rigs. And I did a comparison, side-by-side comparison, and they're pretty damn close.
I always go into an amp, like, when I'm listening to an amp, I'm always expecting it not to sound as good as a 5150, because that's the sound I love. I mean, if it's good enough for At the Gates, it's good enough for me. So when I do hear something like an SLO, it's like, oh, shit, that is tight. Like, that sounds so good.
Well, I'll tell you this, because a lot of people are going to look at my rig. The X88R... It has a very specific mod that I did to it, and I called up Mike Soldano years ago, and he did it for me. He literally told me on the phone recently, he's like, I did like one or two of these, and you were one, you know what I mean? You're like the one guy who asked for this. But I asked him, I was hanging out with Joel from Killswitch, and he's like, put a depth switch on, you know, on that preamp, because he's like, on my SLO head, I have a depth switch. You should ask him if he could do something like that. Because we were listening, and they didn't sound like exactly like the head. So sure enough, I hit up Mike Soldano about that. He put that mod on my X88R. So it was funny. If you don't think Synergy is legit, like, they literally, I called them and asked the same thing. I hit up Mike Soldano. They put me in touch with the Synergy guy who's very, you know, knowledgeable about those modules. And he put that depth switch in there for me. So I have something that no one has right now. But I'm going to say, even without it, it's amazing. But yeah, I asked for a little bit more, like, you know, rumble on the low end. Oh. And it's kind of like what, you know, Soldano had years ago.
Last question about amps before we move on. What specifically about the Rev amp made you play that on Warped Tour as opposed to, you know, the EVH or the, well, obviously you didn't have the Synergy yet, but was it the,
yeah.
Was it the Two Notes technology?
No. I mean, I have a separate Two Notes Torpedo Live, so it didn't really matter what I used. I had a rack case, like a big time rack case that had two, you could fit two heads in it. So I took the EVH out and I took the Rev out. So I told myself, all right, I'm going to give half the time to the Rev and half the time to the EVH. And I found myself playing the Rev a lot. It just had kind of more of a, like a Marshall-y kind of thing happening to it. And for that outdoor kind of venue thing, I liked it better. But I'm not saying that I like it in all applications better than the EVH, because the EVH sounded amazing too. It was just certain days I just wanted a little bit more top-end, Marshall-y top-end. And that's what Rev kind of gave me, even though it's you know, it's a modern-sounding amp, and Marshalls can't sound like the Rev. But it just, it like, I just was always thirsting for that, like, modern amp with that Marshall-y kind of top, and that's what that does really well. And the EVH worked in a different way. I always play with a overdrive pedal, and, you know, I didn't have to put the overdrive pedal on with the EVH. I had enough gain. So, both amps were really great, but I used the Rev probably a little bit more, but the EVH was unbelievable as well.
Yeah, I'm like you. I love an 800 straight up, but I feel like the Rev amps that I've played almost have like a cleaned up 800 vibe. Like Andy from Every Time I Die taught me this years ago, an 800 with a tube screamer, but just like barely on, will really make that amp like, I don't know, it does that zip, that like chainsaw kind of gain that I like, you know? And I noticed that you also, you're a Maxon 808 guy, right? Which is...
Yeah, so Maxon is a huge part of my sound. Kevin down there at Maxon, literally, you know, he and I don't talk often, but it's only because I'm incredibly happy. And, you know, when we see each other, it's always like, hey, how you doing? You need anything? I'm like, no, I'm totally good. I love the 808. The OD808 is like literally... I don't know. It's just the pedal. I put it in a back upside down V and tone straight up in the middle, and it just sounds perfect. So combined with that, and I use MXR, the noise clamp pedal. I really, really like the noise clamp pedal for gate. That's really all that I'm putting in front of my amp. Recently, Unearth started experimenting with some tuning, so I've been using that Digitech drop pedal.
What is it about the Maxon 808? Because, like, everybody makes a tube screamer. There's fucking 800 different tube screamers. Like, what is it about the Maxon? Because I've heard a lot of dudes be like, no, it's got to be, I prefer the Maxon.
Well, the Maxon was, I believe, the company that invented or worked with Ibanez during the period where they were making the golden age of the Ibanez tube screamer, right? So I know that there was some type of disagreement. I think there was some, like, you know, chip disparities or whatever was going on with the chip inside of it. But either way, what the Maxon does for me that I like is that it adds just the right amount of compression to just kind of squash the amp a little bit in the low end and make the low end, like, focused. But it takes away enough of the flubby low end that just kind of smushes it a little bit. And not having it on very much just gives you that really tic-tacky, you know, aggressive, like you know, mosh part chugginess. Right. Not in all amps, though. I mean, sometimes I take it off, like, as I said, with the EVH. It has a bunch of, like, gain on it. So, and it's kind of voiced right, the amp itself. So you don't necessarily have it. It's compressed in the right ways. But, Maxon makes a bunch of other overdrives that are really great too. Sometimes when I'm in the studio, there's this like really thick one. I can't remember what it's called. There's a T9 I use a lot. I think that's in my rack now. The OD808 I use a lot. And there's another fatter one. I always, when I make a record, I try each one of them out just to see with whatever amp I'm playing with, if it agrees with it or not. And, yeah, I just kind of taste test overdrive pedals.
Are you using a ton of different effects, or you're literally just using the Maxon and a noise gate?
I use Axe Effects a little bit, just for effects, as you said, like here and there. I jumped over to Kemper for a minute before the two notes technology was a thing, and it didn't really work for me. It's cool that people like it, but it never really felt like a real. It never really felt like a real amp for me. And going through a cab, it doesn't sound great for me. So once I found the two note stuff, it really changed my life. As far as effects goes, I am all about Eventide. I really, really, really love the H9. That is in my rig, for Europe, the H9 pedal. I'm also going to put a second one in this rack rig that I'm going to show you and take that with me too. But right now I'm using the, it's called the Eclipse. It's a rack mount version of, well, it's the rack. It's one of the 1U rack mount versions that they make, but it's totally equipped with like all the sounds that I need. But the H9 is just so awesome because I could I could be on stage, go into an app, just kind of like move some things around and presets and like move delays around and reverbs and choruses, and my tone's just always solid. And with Unearth, we don't really play to any, we don't play to tracks per se. I mean, we do like Nick plays to a click. And we have a couple like sounds and bass drops and a couple like third guitar rhythm stuff that pops up in our mix. But for the most part, I use that as a channel switcher. Like I send a MIDI cable into my H9, and my H9 just keeps changing patches as I play. So I never have to, you know, worry about my drunk singer stepping on my pedal board like an ox. You know, I like my least favorite thing in the world is like playing, and then my singer comes over and smashes like my pedals, and then next thing you know, I'm on a clean tone trying to riff, you know. It sucks.
Wow, I never even considered the H9 for switching patches during a set. I mean, because it does so much shit, you'd almost need like a college course to really learn the thing inside and out, because it's so in depth.
Yeah, with MIDI, anything that spits out MIDI notes, it'll also take in MIDI notes. So I like the H9 because it's just a simple pedal, it's small. And you plug right into it, and you know, I set it, you know, my patches one through whatever, and yeah, as the set goes, it just changes, and it's like, oh my god, I think I used to pay my guitar tech to like sit there and press buttons. So now that that's over with, my life is just so much better.
So do you just program it to the click that your drummer is playing for the scene changes?
Yeah. Once it gets to a certain part in the song, you know, we use Ableton. So Nick uses Ableton almost like as a playlist. He plays the song, and then the MIDI kind of just triggers as we get to those points in the song.
Hey, that's easy enough. That rules. one less thing to think about.
Yeah, I can time out my delays. I can, you know, have different lead tones for certain things. I can put filters on my guitar during other parts. So it's just, I mean, I know that like Unearth is kind of a barbaric band where we just kind of rock and play and jump off amps and stuff, but the cool part is what you're getting is, you know, we put a lot of effort into our show.
Yeah, that's totally, it's an absolutely noble cause, man. I like it.
And if I could name drop one other thing, I absolutely love Ernie Ball Strings. I know that this is kind of a weird plug, but I gotta say, I was playing a different string company for a very long time, and then I met Tim Dove and he changed my life. These Paradigm 9 through 42 with a low, I play with the low 56, literally changed my life. I've never had such a great time playing guitar strings up until I just recently found these about a year ago, whatever. But Ernie Ball is literally the shit.
Well, hell yeah, dude, this has been great. Before I let you go, let's AB these amps, man. I know people are gonna want to hear that synergy and hear that rev, obviously, and then maybe compare it to something like your EVH, because that's something that people are pretty familiar with.
Yeah, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to play, you know, three different passes of a riff, the same riff, on the Synergy SLO. I'm going to move it over to the rev, and I'm going to move it over to the EVH. And all of them are going to have the same setup, except for the EVH, where I'm going to click off the overdrive pedal. Now, the important thing that I want you to understand is that tone is subjective. The last thing I want in the comment section of this video is for people to be cork sniffing and saying one amp's better than the other. I gotta say, I've given these amps an equal playing field, but it's like in your hands and what you're expecting out of a tone that what matters. So my goal is for you to just hear these amps and understand that I personally think that these are all great amps. And just enjoy what I'm gonna do, and you guys listen for yourself.
Shit, yeah, Ken, man, that was a blast. I'm glad you took the opportunity to sit down and talk with us. I feel like I learned a lot in this rig rundown, so I really appreciate it, man.
Listen, anytime I get an opportunity to hang out with you guys, it's always great for me. So I had such a blast. It's great to let everybody come in and see my rig and check out my amps and stuff, and it's just been an honor being a part of this. And you guys have been super kind to my band, and I can't thank you enough.
Hey, we like your band a lot. Hey, before I let you go, why don't you tell everybody where they can go online to find out more about, because you have developed quite the online presence as a guitar dude, so maybe give it a little plug.
All right, let's do the real plug right now. So in the bottom right-hand corner, you're going to see that I do a YouTube page called Lord of the Rigs. Do me a favor, head over, like and subscribe to my page. Set your notifications so you don't miss anything out. I just interviewed Buzz McGrath from my own band, John Berkland from the Bad Wolves. I'm going to have so many other cool people show up, but I also do like weekly rig rundowns, or I show off plugins. This week I'm going to show off a plugin called Sonable. It's a like a smart EQ where it EQs tones, you know, just it EQs for you actually. So it's like mind-blowing stuff. So please show up to the Lord of the Rigs page. That's where you can find me. Unearth, you know my band. You can find me on Instagram, Ken Susi. But I also have a grunge band coming out called Swivel. You can find us on Instagram. We have a record coming out. Mark Lewis just mixed it, and it's pretty kick-ass. If you like grunge, you'll be into it.
Right on. And obviously, guys, if you don't already, please subscribe to the Premier Guitar YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, all that happy horseshit. And thanks so much for watching. Love you guys.
Later.